We didn't know anything about our architecture, Islamic architecture or pharaonic. We were studying only from a book history.
What was the book, the history of Fletcher?
And it's all, and he called our architecture and the Asian and everything the non-historical styles. That means, and then they corrected it politically in the new publications. But he was right. We are not historical because we are not caught in the vortex of time and fashion. What is true is everlasting. So this is basically explaining the why Hassan Fathi was his genius was in not accepting this modernistic, which was a reaction against the Renaissance, because the Renaissance, Europe had three cultures. They had the Christian and it ended up with the Gothic, and then they got rid of the Christian and they started from the 15th century secularization movement with the Renaissance. And they took the neo-pagan Greco-Roman style as architecture. And you have the Madeleine in Paris, it looks like a bank, it doesn't look like a church anymore. And then, at the same time, the philosophical doctor and the saint and all the people who were the heroes of that period of the Christian became, in the Renaissance, the warrior gentleman, the secular Persian, who became the Napoleon, Wellington, the gentleman, and they dropped the churches and they started building palaces. And they built them in the Greco-Roman style. And of course, the modern was reacting against that. But what happened with the modern is that it became controlled by a new type of man. Not the gentleman warrior, but the businessman, the salesman. And it became the architecture was became functionalist, and they dropped the symbolism, they dropped the ornament, they dropped everything, and just sheer factory type of architecture. In fact, the modern movement started with the factories. So basically, what we have to do now is we don't need doctors of philosophy or PhDs or something. We need doctors of culture in order to preserve our character and identity. And there is one philosopher I know, one of the greatest philosophers now living in the Arab world, from Morocco, and we had the seminar in Turkey, and he said, I'm pulling my hair when I see all the cities that have been built today in the Gulf and the Arab world. And he said, I'm suffering from this because Morocco still has a tradition, especially when you go to Marrakesh, where you have those beautiful courtyard houses, peaceful. The courtyard house was not invented by Zaha Hadid. The courtyard house was representing the, they call it, there was an Italian book, Il Casa di Paradiso, which represents paradise. The courtyard house is sanctity, and it was always in history. The courtyard was very important, whether in Japan, whether in, you have the courtyard universities of Oxford, you have the lady of the court, the law, you still call, I take you to court, because the court was where all the activities happened, and in the old towns also, you have the piazzas. This has all been lost with the modern means. So the kosher is not an intention of a human, it is a cosmological order that has been established even in the Quran. It is the representation of paradise on earth. It is the area of peace. And Ruskin said something beautiful about this. He said, instead of trying to go faster and faster from place to place, we should have learned to have the joy of stopping at home. And this is why today there is violence in the cities. Governments have always been despotic. They've always been, there has always been a lack of fairness. But the world kept going on. Today the violence that's happening in the Arab world is not just of a political or anything. It's because our cities have created this violence. You have today people that sometimes have what they call road rage, where the traffic makes them violent and frustrated. I mean, how long did it take us to get here? It's crazy. I mean, you have a car, Porsches, Range Rovers with horsepower, 400 horsepower, going at the rate of 1 kilometer per hour. When I lived in Beirut, it was faster for me to walk than to take a car. So why do you have all this pollution, all these issues, when you can, by foot, get to your place faster than by car? So, I mean, the sacrifice we are doing for this one, we make fun of other societies that used to throw people in the river, like the Egyptians, they say, for sacrifice, or people who have, they say, it's the cruel forms which go in history. I think a future generation will think that we were crazy to invest all this pollution and all this energy into just moving by cars, which are sophisticated wheelchairs.
Connection between tradition and modernity in his work is what attracted me and is the main focus of my work, which is a bit contained in the book. And what is surprising according to me, and for example, think, I don't know if someone of you visited the Biennale 2 years ago, is that the approach of Fatih's thinking is really contemporary today, and he has still a lot to teach, think about the approach to the place, the idea of the sense of the place, the idea of the character of the place, how to investigate a local context, how to understand which forms are appropriate to that context, and this idea of sustainability, which is not simply environmental sustainability, climatic sustainability, but it, which is a cultural sustainability. So this idea of culture, that is the one that we were speaking about before, that is the main axis of his work.
I don't want to say modernity for Hassan Fatih because I've been compiling so many books on modernity, and modernity was a mentality style. I think the world should be contemporary, and a tradition, but the innovations, they come gradually and very subtle, especially in brick construction. The brick construction has changed a lot now. I'm very happy today that maybe 20 years ago we built one of the largest mosques in Jeddah, the Jafari Mosque, right in the old town. And I was very fortunate to meet the contractor who built it for me and did a beautiful job out of it, Osama Salam. Where are you? Osama? Where are you? Yeah. I would love him to say a few words on the construction because he's one of the best constructors in Saudi Arabia. And we built this mosque. We built this mosque in bricks with domed walls. All that Hassan Fatih has opened for us. And when we first met, he wanted to do it in concrete because contractors only do it in concrete. But I tell you, when we did it in bricks, today we met outside and he was telling people, this is the best job I ever had done. And all those who work in traditional construction, they say, you spoil our life because after that you can't work with concrete. So, you know, the way concrete was promoted with this Hitler of architecture, Corbusier. Yes, he's the Hitler of architecture because he destroyed Paris before the Hitler had the time to bomb it. With his Cité Radieuse or whatever, he just threw towers in no man's land. And when I lived in Paris, I visited his work. It's horrible.
I see it.
Ronchamp, what he did? He did take the head of a man and make the whole roof of the church. He took gutter and he made it like a cannon. And this is not innovation or anything. Of course, everybody, oh, what we see. But this, I studied a bit. I was doing a book on psychology and architecture with a disciple of Jean Piaget. This is called fragmentation and obsession. It's a modern design. disease. What is fragmentation and obsession? You take part of the whole and you blow it up, you become obsessed with it. So in Chandigarh, you cut the hand off, take it and make it huge in the piazza. You take the crescent of a mosque, and I had an architect here in Lebanon who came to me once, and he said, I innovated in the mosque. I said, really, from the Jama Arabiya. I said, what did you do? He said, I took the crescent of the mosque and I made the whole minaret. I said, really? And this is innovation. He said, yes. I said, it's like somebody went and bought a hair and it ended up to his toes. This is a finial. It is an ending. Why do you make the whole minaret? So he said, we disagree in opinion. I said, no, we don't disagree in opinion. He said, what do you mean? I have no opinion. I'm working according to principles. You have opinions. But why should I take a opinion? And so this they don't realize, because they don't understand, they need psychiatrists to tell them they're sick. And they don't realize that this is fragmentation, taking part of something and making it big, being obsessed with it. And this is the whole idea of modern architecture. Can go on with how these designs have and ideas have affected and has also destroyed a lot of Hassan Fathi's initiative to teach at the universities, because the other professors were promoting all this modernity through an inferiority complex that they wanted to be, you know, like a Western city towers.
If I may come in here, and I want to talk about this inferiority complex that we're actually suffering from at the moment in this part of the world, not in Lebanon in particular, but in the whole region. Why Hassan Fathi and the importance of Hassan Fathi in Europe and in the States is so extreme when it comes to this part of the world. There are many students in our universities who don't even know who Hassan Fathi is, discusses this tells you something, no seriously, tells you something about the situation we're in. And what Viola pointed out to about the architecture biennale in Venice 2 years ago, not the last one, the one before, the one that was done by Aravena, that's correct, was completely based on architecture that was based on earth and building materials, and mostly brick. And these experiments were being made in South America, and there was stupendous stuff, and in Venice, in Switzerland, in the laboratories there were different types of vaults and domes and catenaries and explanations of the catenary that Fathi was working on. And while Fathi was working on all of this in the late 30s and 40s and 50s, I was told in the 76, what are you doing? I said, I was at a dinner one evening in Dubai, and they said to me, what are you doing in Cairo? I said, I'm working here with an architect. I'm an intern in his office. And they said, which architect? I said, his name is so-and-so. They said, oh, didn't know who he was. Egyptians, high society in Shahira's house. And then he said to me, which guy, which are you, where does he live? I said, in Al'a, in the Citadel. He said to me, oh, you mean that crazy man who lives in the Citadel? Is that who you're working with? Majnun Daf in Al'a? So this is who I was working with, but that man in particular, I think the book got published thanks to the publishers in the UK, although our sponsor, and thanks to him, we should thank him this evening, Salman Salim bin Laden, who sponsored the publication of this book, but it was the publishers, Lawrence King, who asked me to do the book on Fathi, and it was thanks to the movement in Paris, in France, and in Switzerland, that
actually pushed me to finally get this material published. So I think what we are saying is very important. The West and the universities of the West, I'm sorry to be using this word, I don't know what to say, but are teaching in their curriculums this material, while we have to set up electives. And thanks to the chair, previous chair of my department, set up electives and projects in order, like the one we did in Siwa last year, the vertical studio in Siwa. And the students are very excited and very immersed with this work. And but it's not part of our core curriculum, not only at AUB, but at every single university in the Arab world. Earth and mudbrick and stone and various materials, bamboos, lightweight structures, and all the sustainable materials that are being discussed, plus the sustainable culture we need to maintain, are actually not on our agenda yet. And you know, for us, a country like Yemen that is being bombed today, that has the most sophisticated form of 7 and 8 stories built in sun-dried mudbrick, are areas that are studied in colleagues of mine in Crater, in the south of France, in Grenoble, and in universities in North Africa and in Switzerland. And we are invited to do juries recently in Switzerland because of a project on the architecture of Hassan Fathi, of students of architecture. And here we are totally oblivious of this. And probably we catch up in 20 or 30 years' time, but we won't be here then.
You know, I want to add something to what you're saying. How many people do you think, because they say, how can you make bricks with, you know, now towers and everything? How many stories can you make with the brick structures? Can you guess? Guess. How many? How many floors can you make with a brick structure?
15.
Huh?
15?
You can go up to 30. And this is possible because of the new software in structural calculations. When I started working in Jeddah, I made a warehouse and we used pyramids. Then there was coming the space decks. Now, the space decks couldn't be done before because you have to calculate every number, which was impossible for a structural engineer. But then I went to the University of Guildford. There was a professor there who developed with Formix algebra how to calculate the structures of space decks. And it's amazing because of this Formix algebra, new algebra, and the computer software that's working on it, they could do stadiums, huge domes, very lightweight because of the space decks. So you can see how today, when you innovate through science and through knowledge and through technical developments rather than just innovate by making crazy shapes, the same thing with what happened to space decks, the same thing is happening with bricks today. I've been researching a lot on how to develop this tradition, and I found that with the new software you can easily build up to 20 floors in bricks. There is one in Chicago that is already 20 floors that they took me to show the whole brick structure tower. Also the materials, because brick also especially mud brick, can be damaged by water. In South Africa, we worked with polymers so that the bricks become waterproof. And with a scientist on soil mechanics, and also produced a machine that can produce bricks very fast, instead of drying them in the sun and everything by compression. And how to be efficient and, you know, the production method. You know, like in cars, when Ford produced the assembly line and made the cars cheaper, you can do the same procedure building by bricks, but it's not to reject it because it's an old material. Like I give a lecture in Saudi Arabia and somebody comes up from MIT or Harvard, says, okay, you're a good architect and I admire your work, but why don't you build in the spirit of our age? Use bricks, say, the spirit of these Asians, concrete and steel. And I said, why don't you build in the spirit of the age? And I said, maybe because our age has no spirit anymore. What spirit of the age? Anyhow, you know your story about Hassan Fethi, nobody knows you. When I started working with Hassan Fethi, I left a very good job working for the biggest contractor in Egypt, Osman Ahmad Osman. I left university and I was working for 5 years with Hassan Fethi, not making a penny. And my father was furious because at the time we had this Nasser and he took all our property and land and everything. And for me to sit 5 years working without making any money, he was furious. He said, who is this Hassan Fethi? Nobody knows. Show me a building he did in the city. What are you doing with this old man? He was my age at the time. And I told him, no, Daddy, you know, this man, they don't know him, but I tell you, he's going to be very famous. He said, oh, he's going to be famous. How old is he? I told him, he's 75. He looked at me and he said, no, Shaq Ulum Stabat.
I have to say, for those of you who are interested, we're going to have a talk by Abdul Wahid Wakil, a kind of an informal private talk tomorrow at the UB at 3 p.m. at the Center for Arts and Humanities, which is Ka, and it's near the observatory. It's at 3 and it's from 3 to 4:30, and whoever would like to come, especially the students, are more than welcome. And then we can continue. But I think now we've said enough and we'd like to open the floor for some questions and answers.
Before we do that, I want to say something about Samar. I knew Samar when she came to Hassan Fethi, a young student with eyes full of enthusiasm, and Hassan Fethi was always telling me, what an intelligent girl. And she had humor, she had enthusiasm, and she was really a great contribution to our group. And I want to thank her because her book, I wrote the introduction because there's many books that were written by Hassan Fethi, but they were writers who wanted to get famous by making the book on Hassan Fethi. They never lived with him, they never worked with him. Samar lived with him, served him, helped him. He cherished her because she was like a daughter taking care of this old man. And her book is of value because she lived with a great man, Hassan Fethi, and never made the book just for to become famous or anything. It was a long-awaited book, and if she wanted to be famous making that book, she would have done it before all her books on Yemen. And I came specially for the memory of Hassan Fethi and to thank Samar for having done this book and this gorgeous Italian woman, Viola, which I met for the first time today.
But we had some fantastic times together, and every time Abdul Wahid sees me now, he says, we used to laugh so much, why have we stopped laughing? And it's true, we used to be over the floor with laughter at Hassan Fethi's. So there are many stories to tell, but there's another time.
One story that killed us, she won't remember this. There was a school that Hassan Fethi did for the government education or something. And then they told him, go and see a roof or something fell. There was some water leak and so on. And of course, mud brick with a water leak, if you don't maintain it, it's a disaster. So Hassan Fethi, I don't know if you were with us, said, Wahid, come, let's go and see this, what's happened to this school in some village. I drove him off there and we went down from the village and he said, where's the head of the school, the headmaster? And came in and he said, what's wrong? What are you? He said, what's wrong? We have somebody outside guarding the school. We're afraid somebody with a bicycle passing by stops to pee on one of the walls, the whole school will melt down. I said, very good. He said, cochon. And of course, I felt, I was telling her, somebody, we're afraid. That is how they were, you know, they all want concrete and this. But this was one of the stories, I mean, that. Didn't stop laughing when this happened.
Questions and answers. Has anybody got any questions? No. Good.
No. There's somebody there.
Not a long philosophical question, please. People are tired.
Abdul Wahid, can you tell us about the master and disciple thing? A master and disciple. And you speak about Hassan Fethi as a master and you as a disciple for Hassan Fethi. The relationship between the master and the disciple and the apprentice.
Yes, even in Oxford, you have the tutor. The master disciple is a very important role. And in tradition, people used to travel from city to city in Italy and so on to go and work with the master. And in order to absorb the master, they used to serve him. You know, mix his paints, do menial jobs, clean the studio, whatever. And by doing this, you become receptive, because the relationship of the master and the disciple, it's like masculine and feminine. One is giving and the person is receiving. So there is a very strong bond when the disciple is willing to receive, he's open. But if you go, I've seen people come to Hassan Fethi from Berkeley and everything, and they think they know everything and they're arrogant. And if you are not allowed to receive, you cannot learn. So there was a training of the disciple that he becomes like a sort of hunger in order to learn. The mason that I was working with, Hassan Fethi introduced me to Amala. I told him, Amala, you're an old man now. And if you die, how will I build domes? So I want you to teach me how to build it. And you know, masons, they have the great secret, they don't give architects anything. So, are you willing to teach me how to build the dome? He said, okay. So I went up and stood on the scaffold to build the dome. He said, by the way, once you're up here, you take away your architect's hat. I said, what does that mean? He said, if you make a mistake,
he knocks the brakes for it. And I looked at him and I says, Ala, Amala, why is your education so cruel? I see the mechanic hitting the boy, and why to teach somebody you have to knock my knuckles and the other? Why is it so violent, your way of education? He said, you want to know why? I said, why? He said, well, you see, in architecture school, if you make a mistake, you have a rubber. Here, we make a mistake, we're both dead under the dome. And this is the master-disciple relationship. It's not just somebody talking about architecture, but also practice. Now, our universities broke this because of the mentality of the West of the white collar and the blue collar. And always the engineers and I looked down upon my mason, although I always considered him full of knowledge, but they looked, you know, he's a mason. They treated him with disrespect. They don't accept that knowledge, but they have amazing knowledge. I mean, there are many stories I could tell you, but this is the problem with education today, and I tried to change it when I became dean for 5 years of the faculty of faculty of Islamic Studies as head of architecture and urbanism. I tried to change the curriculum, but all the other professors wouldn't accept it because they don't want to work with the hands. They just want to sit and write, go to books, copy the words, and finish it and do a thesis. And they are so stupid, you could see there's nothing they can learn from it. I did this when I was visiting professor in the University of Miami. I saw the students couldn't draw anything. They didn't know anything about structures. Everything they drew was wrong. 50 students. So I told the professor, I told him, I want to bring the contractor here, bring bricks and everything, and I want the students to build the vaults and build the domes. I don't, because they don't want to draw, I want them to see. So I explained the theories and everything. I said, now you're going to go and build it. Everything they did collapsed. Because they learned nothing from the theory. The reality, they built the boat and it slipped. It all fell. Because they didn't have to give it support for the thrust. So I told the professor, you see, you teach them nothing. Because this theory doesn't go in their mind. A dome, they can't see how the dome ends up into a square with a pendentive and three-dimensional triangles and the squinch. So, what are you teaching? And this is what happened with the universities. They split the practice and the theory. White collar, blue collar. So, in America now, when I was working there, the architects don't do any details. It's all, they leave all the things to the contractor. They don't know how to make any construction details. Even books, when you used to buy before those sheets, black books, which was detail sheets, now we don't have even the books on architecture. I can't read them. The plans, before you see the first floor, the second floor, you see how this works. Now it's just the graphics. So, I mean, it is very worrying, the situation. And this is because, basically, the loss of the master-disciple, when people used to work with architects, even when I had my office in London, the Bartlett School and the other schools, when students came to train with me, they said they learned in 1 year more than what they learned 5 years at university. And he said, why is that? I said, because they are working with the real, not illusionary projects. Everything they are drawing here, they're seeing built after month. They see the photographs, see the construction in our videos. So they are seeing they're working with something real. But the schools, they are working with illusion, with projects that can never be built. You have to leave the schools. When they divided this, you have an architectural school that teaches you designs projects that cannot be built, and you have in real life projects that are built that do not have architecture. So you have all the admins that is existing. And the master really, before even the Bozar, used to go and train with an architect who built today the law in Saudi Arabia and in Qatar. If you teach at university, you're not allowed to practice as an architect. This is ridiculous. Everything is dying. Go to YouTube and put Subversion, and you'll see how they are in mind control. You'll see how they are destroying our culture, and they are dragging us without any hashish or anything. The worst drug, which is making you stop to think. And they have the subversion is through university, through artists, through fake governments. And I have papers on the CIA, how it promoted modern art to confuse people. You have these things now on YouTube open. You can see them. But people don't understand modern art. When you go to Jeddah and you see in every roundabout a bicycle 10 times.
Thank you very much.